Last time, we kind of just are systematically going through the use of grace in the New Testament, and I'm not pulling out every time the word is used. What I'm pulling out is every time it is said that grace does something in us, to us, through us, with us, that grace is this or that. You know, a lot of times Paul will say something like, God keep you in his grace, that we're not looking at those. That's more of a closing thing. So what we've learned so far for those who have been kind of disconnected by the last few weeks since I taught is that grace with being sent is for the obedience of the faith, and the obedience of the faith is what? It's caring for the outcast. This is what it looks like to follow Jesus, is that we minister to the least of these. Grace has freely justified, past tense, all men collectively. And I like to make sure we throw those in because we need to understand all people, not all men. We need to understand that what grace has done to and for humanity was done in the past tense, and it was done collectively to all. Grace is the place in which we already stand. Grace is free, and one of the things we need to start doing is learning to read with intent. And when something is called free, what does that mean? It means that there is nothing that can be done to pay for it. When something is called good, what does that mean? It means that there is nothing in it that is bad. When Jesus says, fear not, it means that there is, in fact, no reason to be afraid. He couldn't say that otherwise. Grace is not some proof that we cannot sin, but it's an overwhelming force when we do. And this is one that, you know, it kind of gets brought up over and over and over. And, you know, we've got to learn to rightly discern what's being said in the scripture a lot of time. And that is that there are two voices going on, two stories being told throughout the New Testament. You have the story of what God has done to the world through the Son, by the Spirit. And then you have the story or the verses that are written to those who say they follow Christ. And these are two different things, and we've got to learn to rightly discern what's going on, because a lot of our argument, a lot of our problem in seeing certain things is caused by the fact that we're not looking, we just assume that this verse then applies to everybody. Well, it doesn't. You know, God, Jesus is the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world, and I agree with that. And sin from the mindset of breaking God's law, from the mindset of doing something that bothers the Father, has been utterly removed. It's been separated as far as the East is from the West. But we still have in one of John's letters, he says, confess your sins one to another, that you may be made whole. And so when we begin to transgress against each other, look, that's sin, and we don't need to get so caught up in, oh, we're sinners. If you screw up, say sorry. Okay, there's the English modern version of it. And surprisingly, we would all nod our heads, well, yeah, of course, but that's probably the least done thing in the body. We would so much rather just talk about someone behind their back, send emails, texts, private Facebook messages, do all the things that we do to talk bad about people behind their backs and never just go to the person and say, look, I'm sorry. Because going and saying I'm sorry is hard. Confrontation sucks. And we don't want to have to admit that we've done something wrong. And it's real easy in the tech era that we live in to just move away from that person rather than try and restore the relationship. We learn that differing gifts are given by grace, and you know, this is something that I think we need to latch on to. In this modern kind of anti-institutional church movement, we've got this whole, well, everybody's a pastor. No, they're not. And that's okay. Everybody can be, not everybody is. And remember, if that is welling up inside of you, probably what you have is too high an image of a pastor. And you need to just let the image come down rather than trying to bring everybody else up to what you have this exalted to. And that would apply to prophet, that would apply to apostle, all of the things that they're differing gifts. It's okay. You don't have to do everything. Nobody has to be anything. You can if you want to, and I'm sure everybody could learn to be a pastor, and that's great, but not everyone is. And we talked about how, you know, if we were to take this into the secular world and I were to walk into CSU and everybody's a professor and just go into some biology class and try and teach, it's not going to work. That grace then is what makes us what we are, that we are not self-made, we are made by grace. Grace enables us to live simply and sincerely. That grace causes thankfulness to abound to the glory of God. That grace causes us to desire to give unto every good work. And we talked about, in order to qualify as a good work, and at least in Paul's understanding, it would have to be ministering reconciliation. Because that's the only ministry he ever says that we've been given. He never says you've been given a ministry of separation so that the folks who have the ministry of reconciliation can come along and clean up. No. The only ministry you've been given is reconciliation. And then we learned last time that grace is sufficient amid sickness or persecution. However you want to view Paul's thorn, that's fine. I don't care. I don't care if you think it's a sickness. I don't care if you think it's a person. The bottom line is not what the thorn was. The bottom line is that his grace is sufficient. So let's continue on. Let's go to Galatians 1. We're going to read, and today this is all we're going to do is we're going to stay in Galatians, and we're going to go a little quicker so that we can get out of here. Galatians 1, 6 through 7 says, I marvel that you are turning away so soon from him who called you in the grace of Christ to a different gospel, which is not another, but here there are some who trouble you and want to pervert the gospel of Christ. So what we see then is that grace is equal to the gospel. Him who called you in the grace of God, grace of Christ, to a different gospel. And sadly, what we've presented a lot of times is something that looks nothing like that. We have said that the gospel is an ultimatum of choose him or die, and we've made up these little phrases like born once, die twice, born twice, die once, turn or burn, and other such unscriptural, non-biblical nonsense. And that's really what it is. It's not the gospel. It's Western salesmanship at its finest. And we have turned the gospel into a message that is really a large meeting of people that we're just trying to sell things to. And what we're trying to sell them on is fire insurance. And that is never what the gospel is about. Does the gospel involve the afterlife? Sure. Absolutely. Is that what it's all about? No, absolutely not. If you were not here Wednesday, please go listen to the message because I don't want to teach the whole thing again. We love our fantastic, sensational brand of Christianity that we've been giving the world. But I believe that the very reason people are rejecting Christianity right now, the way that we've presented it, is that the Holy Spirit's inside them telling them, nope. The Father is not a God who offers an ultimatum. He's here to love you unconditionally and uncontrollably. And that might be hard for some of us to swallow. The message of the gospel is and always will be exactly what I have on my arm. You are included. Grace is the gospel, and the gospel is grace. These two need to be understood as synonymous. We only stand to pervert it, as Paul said, when we want to add to it. And so what we've been giving is a perverted gospel. It's one that is so far off the original message that it's unrecognizable in many aspects. Paul says, turning away so soon from him who called you in the grace of Christ to a different gospel, which is not another. What he's saying is, even though he has called it a different gospel, it doesn't even qualify as gospel. He's saying, which is not another gospel. It's not even in the same field as what the gospel is. Let's go on to 16 and 17, and still in chapter 1. But when it pleased God, who separated me from my mother's womb, we all know this one because of this is one we like to hit on here, and called me by his grace to reveal his son to me, in me, that I might preach him among the heathen. Immediately I conferred not with flesh and blood. Now again, we've gone over this all the time. We've pointed out that it says in me. And yet we read this and we don't make this the message that we bring. When it pleases God to reveal his son to you, you might make a free will decision. No, when it pleased God to reveal his son in me that I might preach him among the heathen, he is pleased that we are filled. You know, I believe that when God's speaking in the garden and however we view the creation story, you know, the point of the creation story is not whether or not it's a literal six-day creation. The point of the creation story is that God stood at the beginning and declared from the beginning what he saw in the end, it is good. And he could not have said it is good if there was in fact any part of it that was bad. Okay, he didn't say it's halfway good. It's kind of good. Jesus, we can fix it. He said it's good. So grace here is what called Paul. It's what invaded his will, knocked him off his horse, and appeared to him in a mystical encounter. Okay? And I'm not going to get into all of the discourse on free will right now, but we love to talk about free will, and yet the guy we base most of our gospel on had his will utterly invaded by the Spirit of God. Knocked him off his horse. Who are you persecuting? And he's like, whoa, who is this? And he says, it's me. It's Jesus. Let me invade your will for a moment and show you what you're doing. And it pleased God to reveal his son in this man who was what? A murderer? A persecutor? A thief? And it pleased God to reveal his son in him. He didn't appear and teach him Jesus. He revealed Jesus in him, and then Jesus in him taught him. You know, this week at the conference, Baxter said some amazing stuff. And one of the things he said is, he said, you know, when we really get down to it, what we need to look at in the gospel is our contribution to salvation. Murder, rejection, deceit. That was our contribution. And the Father said, I'm going to take your murder, and I'm going to take your rejection, and I'm going to take your unbelief, and I'm going to work that to enact something in you. And he does the same thing in Paul. Because of his grace, he takes all that and he works that and he shows Paul the Son in him. Grace is what did the calling, what led to the revelation of Christ inside. And look, this is how God always works. If we go back and look at everything, he always works from within. He is not a God who applies outside pressure. And we could go as far then as to say that any message that does not reveal your already included state in the fellowship that the Father, Son, and Spirit share is a message that is not of the gospel. And I want us to get that. If we learn to read Paul correctly, if we begin to look at what he's saying, if we stop cherry-picking our favorite verses that talk about certain people in and out, and go ahead and read, you know, Romans is the big one, and read Romans start to finish. Romans start to finish is all about victory over sin. It's all about Jesus overcoming what has happened. And the picture is inclusion. Why did it please him? Why did it please God that Paul may preach among rather than to or at the heathen? He doesn't say that I may preach to the sinners. He says among, meaning working from within. And this word is not heathen as we would think of it. It's been mistranslated. The word is ethnos, and it's literally the nations. It has nothing to do with saved or unsaved, believer or unbeliever. It has to do with Paul's specific ministry calling, which was what? The Gentiles. Okay, he's not just saying that this is an evil group of people. What he's saying is, I've not been called to the Jews. There's other people that are called there. This is where I'm called. God would never, or grace, I mean, would never appeal to someone that it might exclude others. And we need to take that to heart. Galatians 2, 20 to 21, and we all know this. I am crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live, yet not I, but Christ lives in me, and the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. I do not frustrate the grace of God, for if righteousness come by the law, then Christ is dead in vain. I live my life by the faith of the Son of God, of rather than in. And I know we hit this and we pound it, but we need to get this. We are not living by our faith in Christ. We are living by his faith in us. It's his faith from within that is revealed by grace. Then Paul says something here that I know I've heard a lot of bad sermons on, but that grace can be frustrated. I've seen books called Frustrated Grace. And they want to talk about, you know, at the loosest point, they're talking about, well, you frustrate grace when you try and observe the law. Or you frustrate grace when you think about fishing while you're supposed to be worshiping. I saw a thing the other day, it was actually cool, I'm thinking about getting it hung up in the church. It says that religion is a man sitting in church thinking about fishing. Faith is a man sitting in a boat thinking about God. So let's read this closely because I think it's important what Paul outlines for us here that can frustrate grace. And the word frustrate means reject. Okay, so he says, I do not reject the grace of God. And this doesn't mean I don't want it. Okay, this is a, when you do this, it rejects grace statement. Okay, what rejects grace? Believing that righteousness comes by the law. And we would likely look back and say, oh yes, this means that we don't observe the Levitical law, the priestly ordinances, the Ten Commandments, or any of the holiness codes that have been passed down through the ages. It does mean that. But the word here is not the word that simply means Old Testament written law. Okay, the word is nomos, and it means all law, and even and especially the Christian law that demands faith. If righteousness comes by even the Christian law that demands faith, it frustrates grace. It rejects grace. When we begin to tell people that your righteousness has something to do with your reception, it frustrates the grace of God. It pushes grace away. Okay? We can never get out from under grace. But it helps to enact the rejection of it real quickly. And we need to understand this. We need to understand that people are not born in sin, they are born righteous. Do we learn to sin through life? Absolutely. But we are born righteous. We are born in a position accepted by the Father. And when we begin to heap that law back on top of people saying, well, you have to do this, 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 and this to be righteous. That frustrates grace. And yeah, it applies to that Old Testament stuff. It applies to, well, you know, look, if you lie, if you cheat, if you do these things, if you steal, then, well, yeah, it applies to that too. But what does Paul say? He doesn't say if righteousness comes by observing the law or not breaking the law. He just says if it comes by the law. Okay, so you're not righteous because you don't break law. You're righteous because grace has made you righteous. This is what Romans is all about. Righteousness has come to all men. The free gift has come to all men because of the obedience of one man. So why then would demanding faith for righteousness frustrate grace? Because we cannot become something through work that we have already been made by grace. Let's put this in a natural term. If my kids were to come to me and say, Dad, I just really want to be a miller. And this is what we do. We present this, well, you can be righteous. So people come and they say, God, I just want to be righteous. Lord, prepare me. And we sing all these songs. Make me holy, make me righteous. And God's saying, there's not much I can do. That's already your name. You're already a miller. You're already a righteous. You're already a holy. You're already a loved, a justified. You're a son, a daughter of God. Therefore, you cannot help but be anything but those things. I think this is the primary reason Jesus likes to reveal God as Father, is to dispel the old lie, which is actually not that old. We're talking 16, 1700 that this belief even came around, that people are born in sin. He's saying, nope, can't be. God's your Father. I'm amazed at how that belief has hung on. It's not scriptural. You can't find it anywhere. There is one verse where David says, in sin did my mother conceive me. And if you go read the context, he's offering an excuse for his actions. He's basically copping out for having an affair with Bathsheba. Oh, it's my mom's fault. Oh, she was a sinner, and so she had me, and I'm obviously going to sin. And this is what, oh, well, yes, and sin does our mother. No, look. That's not a doctrine. It's a cop-out. I'm amazed at how much we use cop-outs in the scripture to form doctrines. We do it out of Job. We do it out of the Psalms. We pull stuff from Moses. Though he slay me, yet will I serve him. We pull all this stuff out of Job, and in the end, just read the last chapter. God reprimands him and his friends. You guys don't know what you're talking about. He makes his friends go apologize to him. Paul then goes on in Galatians 5 to say that anyone who attempts to be justified by the law, and it's the same word nomos, is fallen from grace. So that means when you attempt to be justified by any law, even the Christian law that requires faith, if you think that justification comes through your faith, you have fallen from grace. Does this mean that you're not under grace? No, it means that that is not what you are allowing to be the driving force in your life. You're allowing your own work to be the driving force in your life. And fallen literally means to make something powerless. Okay? So it doesn't mean that you're away from it. It doesn't mean you fell down the hill and grace is up the hill and now you have to climb back up. No, it means you've frustrated it. You've made it powerless in your life. You want to have grace be powerful in your life? Stop frustrating it by trying to observe the law, even the new covenant law that we've created, that Jesus never created, that Paul never created. We've talked enough here about what saved, salvation, and born again mean, and those don't refer to being in a state of righteousness or justification. Those were gifts of God to the world, righteousness and justification. Getting saved, professing belief in Christ, is all about doing what Jesus said he came to do. I have come that they should have an afterlife, life, and have it abundantly. When we want the fullness of what Jesus has provided, when we want to begin to see more in our lives of what he is and what he's done, this is when we, yeah, you know what? I believe this. He's my Lord. And when we begin to profess him as Lord, you know what that does? It's not a one-time thing. It means that in every situation, no matter what's coming at me, I'm going to profess him as Lord. You know, and this is another thing we've done in this whole grace, quote, movement, is we've said, oh, well, okay, now, you've done your come up front, confess your sins, pray, cry at the altar, go get baptized. Now, from now on, you're good. And you are good, okay? But there is some power to, in every situation, reminding yourself, no, Jesus is Lord. And as we read through, and this is where I love historical context, that one of the primary claims of the gospel is that Jesus is Lord and Caesar is not. When you see in Romans that Paul continually, Jesus, the Lord and our Lord, and the Lord and our Lord, and he is right in the face writing a letter to the church in Rome, smacking the emperor, because Caesar was the only one allowed to be called Lord. And Paul says, nope, Jesus is Lord, and Caesar is not. Over and over and over. And this is what the Christian life is all about. It's about surrendering to Christ in that moment where I feel like I'm so pissed off, I'm going to punch a hole in the wall. Yeah. Let him give you peace in that moment. Get saved in that moment. We need to learn what these words are for. When sickness comes against us, Jesus is Lord. Get saved in that moment and get healed. Stop trying to fall back on, well, I made this confession 15 years ago. Actively surrender to him. It's not works to do that. And this is what I die daily means. It means I let go of my agenda, because my agenda doesn't matter anymore. And we need to do that daily. Because if we're not letting go of our agenda, then it's our agenda that's dictating where we go. You know, it gets real frustrating in ministry trying to do your own agenda all the time. Because you'll find, I've done it, you know, I've traveled places and I've gone and nobody shows up. And it's like, what's going on? God's like, I didn't tell you to go there. Oh, so I had a vacation. Yes, you did. Did you enjoy it? Yeah, I had fun. Good. So do we wonder why we're in the state that we're in today? Where we are possessing a form of godliness but denying its power. You know how you deny its power? It's not by saying, well, I don't believe in the gifts of the Spirit. It's by frustrating grace, because it's grace that's sufficient. And we've whittled this stuff down and we've said, well, you know, if your active decision-making faculties aren't involved, or if you don't say, yes, I believe in the power of the Spirit, then you're just going to live a powerless life. No, the power, it doesn't have anything to do. The Spirit does give us power. But you know what? He's going to give and give and give, because the gifts of God are without repentance. But when we begin to frustrate grace, it makes things powerless. And how do we do this? Through nomos. Through these laws of reception, belief, and faith. And I am not telling you don't need to believe in Jesus. What I am telling you is that the reason we have told you need to believe in Jesus is a lie. The reason you need to believe in Jesus is because he wants to give you life. And a lot of it. He wants you to smile at the end of the day as you lay down and not be stressed. And this doesn't mean that things are never going to come against us. One of the more obscure promises of the Bible is what? In this world, you will have tribulation. Not might. You know, we love our promises in our prosperity movement circles and, oh yes, all the promises of God are yes and amen in Jesus. Even that one. Ouch. You will have tribulation. There are going to be times when you're going to look at your life and you go, this sucks. And Jesus is going to go, I know, and I walked through it, and I'm here to help you. And for whatever reason, he doesn't just yank us up out of it immediately. And we have hard times, and people die, and we get sick, and things happen, and we lose money, and we go bankrupt, and you know, we go through divorces, and we lose custody, and we do all these things. And all along, Jesus is feeling the same pain that we're feeling. And he's trying to say, I can walk with you through this. I don't know who that was for. So when we render grace powerless through laws of reception, belief, and faith, what we got to understand is those things are not fruit. are not seeds. They are fruit. Faith is not a seed. Faith is a fruit. Belief is not a seed. It's not that we sow enough belief that God finally puts his son in us. When it pleases him to reveal his son in us, guess what happens? It grows and grows, and all of a sudden, faith, belief come out. Reception comes out. All the things that we've tried to give people, tried to tell people that you need to do in order to be, it's almost like we didn't read Genesis 1 when the serpent says you need to do this in order to be. And we said, that's neat, but we're going to keep doing the same thing. And we wonder why people are in such a state now. We've created little gardens of Eden in their hearts, and we've told them, you are not like God, but you can be if you just do this. And then the separation in their hearts starts. And we wonder why they're frustrated, and we wonder why they're not jumping on this message. Why they're not flocking to Jesus anymore. Instead, we need to be looking at people and we need to be saying, look, this is who you are. The Father has put his Son in you. This is who he sees you as. This is how he sees you. This is how much he loves you. And then guess what's going to happen? Faith's going to go, poof. And they're going to say, yeah, I want to know that God. I hear this over and over from people. You know, I left the church, but the type of God that you preach, I could believe in. Good. And I've not been beating them up and telling them, well, you're going to go to this eternal torture chamber forever if you don't profess Jesus as your Lord and Savior. I've been just, this is who God sees you as. He sees you as perfect. He sees you as holy, as blameless, and above reproach. And people want to argue with me, and that's fine. I teach my kids this at home. So guess what? The next generation is going to know it from early on. Parents, this is what we need to be teaching our kids. From day one. And it's not too late to start. I don't care if we started out with this, well, you're born a sinner. We can go to our kids and repent. I've done it. I don't know if you know this about me, but I have kind of a short fuse. Surprise. And I've gone to my kids and repented and said, look, I was wrong there. And they're like, what? You can't be wrong, you're dead. No, I can be wrong, I'm human. All these things that we want to see, and they're good things to want to see. Look, the motives are never bad. I will never say, well, at least so far, I've not met anybody that's gotten into the ministry for the money. I've not met anything. That's funny. I've never met anybody. Few of you get that because it's not very good. I've never met anybody that is doing what they do because they want people to feel like crap at the end of the day. Even the ones that are severely legalistic, they're doing it because they have a good goal in mind. But the problem is good intentions don't do much when the theology is crap. And when we build these little gardens in people's hearts and we tell them, look, you are not, and we whisper like the serpent, you are not like God, but you can be. You are not accepted, but you can be. You are not reconciled, but you can be. Just eat of this tree. God knows that you'll be like him if you do. You see, when we put it like that, everybody gets it. This is what we're called to do. We're called to just give him the tree of life, which is who? Jesus. Feed him that tree and watch faith come out. I can't help but have faith in my wife because I know her. I don't wish upon my wife. And this is what we've given people. Well, if you believe enough, if you wish enough, Jesus will come down off of whatever distant star he's living on. And he'll live in your heart as if you could be alive without him there to begin with. There's a reason John says that he holds all things together. Because he literally holds all things together. If he were gone, we'd be gone. So grace is this means by which Christ the seed was placed into every person, to every part of the cosmos. He holds all things together. It was in and through and by him all things were made. It was for him all things were made. By him all things consist. You know, these guys had a real good vision of Jesus. They had a much bigger vision of Jesus than we do. I think we're starting to recover some of that. I think we're starting to realize that everything that we think we know needs to be processed through the lens of Christ. That whether it be from the Bible text itself or from a man standing up front, any revelation of Father needs to go through the revelation of Father that Jesus gave us. We all would say amen if I said that about some guy standing up here false prophesying over you. Oh, God is angry. And I'd say, that doesn't line up with who Jesus has revealed God to be. And you'd all go, amen. But then we read in our Bibles, God is angry, and we all go, amen. Let's allow Jesus to be the lens that everything passes through, even fellow humanity. So that when we look in them and we look in their eyes, whose eyes are we looking in? Christ's. When we look into their heart, when we see what's going on, you know, it's real easy to get all caught up in what we think people's problems are. Oh, well, they're just not doing this, this, or this. That's real easy to do from the outside. Much harder to willingly identify with their suffering and take it on and see Jesus in the midst of that and say, okay, now how do we heal this? How do we deal with this? What needs to happen here? And this is what grace does for us. Amen? Amen.